It was a beautiful and tranquil Sunday evening in January of 1891. 15 members from various German royal families decided to go on a nice sleigh ride hosted by Kaiser Wilhelm II's sister, Charlotte von Preußen, and afterwards enjoy a nice evening in the Jagdschloss Grunewald. Champagne flowed, the mood was excellent, there was dancing, and gradually, clothes were taken off, and then group sex happened. Man on woman, woman on woman, man on man, or everything at once. Everything was possible on that evening. Luckily, this sexual adventure among some of Germany's most prestigious individuals would never come to public light, right? Right? Already on the very next day, a number of anonymous letters were sent to the participants, containing very detailed descriptions of the events. Sometimes even pictures of pornographic acts with the faces of the participants glued on top were delivered. And no, I'm not going to show them to you, you filthy perverts. Anyway, because most nobles usually had servants who opened the letters for them, you can imagine that they were quite intrigued by what they saw, and so those letters and their contents didn't remain secret for very long, and soon, all of Berlin knew what had happened. Now, why was this such a big deal? First, we should probably look at who was actually present. First, we have Ernst Günther von Schleswig-Holstein, Kaiser Wilhelm II's brother-in-law. He had already established quite a reputation for himself as someone who enjoys the company of prostitutes a bit too much. For that reason, he was often called Herzog Rammler, which can roughly be translated with Duke Shagger. Then we also have the Duke and the Duchess von Hohenau, who had been married for 10 years. They were an unusual couple because Friedrich von Hohenau was homosexual, while his wife frequently used her beauty and charm to seduce a number of men at the royal court. Her conquests include a young Kaiser Wilhelm and another participant at the Grunewald party, Prince Friedrich Karl von Hessen, who would later become the King of Finland. For that she was often called the Lottchen von Preußen, because while it was socially acceptable for men to have sexual relationships outside of their marriage, the same cannot be said for when a woman did it. It was seen as such a dishonourable and unusual thing that it was seriously argued that sexually active women were either suffering from a form of porphyria or simply hysteria. Apart from that, we also have the issue that same-sex intercourse occurred at Grunewald, because under Imperial German law, that was illegal and could be punished with prison, for men at least. While members of the German royal court usually did not have to fear the up to 10-year-long prison sentence, they were very often discredited and publicly made fun of. In the late 19th century, homosexuality was seen as an unnatural illness that could be spread like any other virus. Of course, this narrative was heavily criticized by some doctors, psychiatrists, and lawyers, but they were in the minority. Most men considered homosexuality to be the absolute opposite of manliness, and therefore a threat to the stability of the state. The main reason for why the Grunewald party became such a big public spectacle was that the participation of gay men and sexually active women stood in direct opposition with the noble and honorable royal court. The German royal court was one of the biggest in Europe, consisted of 3,500 noble people, and devoured about 20% of the entire imperial budget. It also had an unusual amount of influence on the German political sphere. You can imagine that these noble gentlemen were not too amused when people from the lower classes began to make fun of them and insult their honour. And for that reason, a culprit for the letters had to be found. And quickly. Some of the participants at Grunewald contacted the police, and one of Berlin's best detective inspectors, Eugen von Tausch, was tasked with solving the case. Tausch quickly suspected that Ernst Günther von Schleswig-Holstein might be the mysterious letter writer. Because of his bad reputation, he was an easy target, but there was simply no proof against him. Von Tausch didn't give up, illegally monitored the Duke's mailboxes, and even stole some blotting sheets from his house. Ernst Günther got quite angry at this and threw the detective out of his house. After that, he joined a small circle of hobby detectives, consisting of the Hohenau couple, a certain Karl Freiherr von Schrader, and some other participants. It didn't take them very long to find the perfect scapegoat, the master of ceremonies and another Grunewald participant, Leberecht von Kotze. Von Kotze was an unusual character. He stood out with his colourful taste of clothes, and he absolutely loved gossiping. For that reason, other members of the royal court often called him feminine. Upon inspecting the letters, a graphologist argued that they could only have been written by a pathologically feminine person of conceited and pompous appearance. Although there was absolutely no evidence that he had ever written any of these letters, the Hohenhaus and von Schrader managed to convince the Kaiser of von Kotze's guilt. Wilhelm II quickly had von Kotze arrested and imprisoned at a house in the Lindenstraße in June of 1894. The problem was that the Kaiser theoretically had absolutely no right to do this, as prosecuting von Kotze would have been a job for a civilian court. So von Kotze was taken to a military court, even though he was no officer, so the Kaiser simply made him a cavalry captain for this position. All of this was pointless, however, because while von Kotze was in prison, more letters arrived. So it was clear that he could not possibly have been the culprit, and he was released. The Kaiser, however, was not convinced. He wanted to see to it that justice is done, and commissioned an investigation committee to find evidence against von Kotze. But, of course, they couldn't find anything, and the military court ruled that he was innocent. This time, the Kaiser was also convinced. He forced the Duke of Schleswig-Holstein and the Duke of Hohenau to apologize to von Kotze, which they did. Three people who accused Kotze didn't apologize, however, and among them was von Kotze's archenemy, Karl Freiherr von Schrader. Von Kotze was understandably pissed off, and challenged von Schrader to a duel. In April of 1895, they both met near the Haarlensee train station and drew their pistols. In this engagement, von Kotze got wounded and sent to hospital. There, Wilhelm II visited him and gave him a lovely Easter egg. Now, you might think that, finally, it's all over, everything is settled. And you couldn't possibly be more wrong. But in order to understand the following events, we should first look at why the duel even happened in the first place. In the German Empire, in order for a man to be considered a man, he had to be the exact opposite of a woman. Not just in his taste of clothing, but also in the way he acted. There was no way he could ever show his soft side. He also had to be tough, no matter to whom, and may the gods help him if he ever showed a tear. Boys in Imperial Germany were raised this way, not just at home, but also at school and in the military. Von Kotze had been accused of being effeminate, and therefore his honour had been greatly damaged. By challenging von Schrader to a duel, he could prove his manliness to everyone. But duels were actually forbidden by law, and they were already growing out of fashion. After von Kotze got out of hospital, he sued von Schrader for defamation. Von Schrader was very unhappy about this and challenged von Kotze to another duel. He in turn declined and argued that the two should wait until the end of the court case. For declining the duel, von Kotze was dishonored and kicked from the army by the honorable court in Rathenow. The Kaiser decided that he should intervene and sided with the former master of ceremonies. He argued that von Kotze should instead be warned and given the chance to redeem his lost honor. Wilhelm II thus absolutely made sure that this actually illegal duel just had to happen. Both contestants met near Potsdam to finally settle who was the most honourable once and for all. At the end of the duel, von Schrader paid with his life, and von Kotze was the victor. Now, normally, for killing a person, von Kotze should have been sentenced to death, or at the very least be sent to prison for a very, very long time. But instead he was sent to 2 years of imprisonment in the fortress of Glatz. It was a very pleasant time for him, because his cell was spacious, he could spend the time with his friends, and he was supplied with champagne. After just 3 months, the Kaiser pardoned him, and von Kotze was free to leave, and he even received an Order of the Eagle. Obviously, as you can imagine, a lot of people were very upset about this. Why can someone from the royal court kill a man and almost be rewarded for it when people get sent to prison for far less severe crimes? Especially the Social Democrats criticized that their journalists and politicians were often sent to prison, and the newspapers started to print caricatures about it. Publicly, the Kaiser's and his royal court's reputation had hit rock bottom, because not only had this public murder happened, but it had also been approved by the Kaiser. This situation started a 2-day-long debate in the Reichstag in April of 1896. Especially the Social Democrats and the Liberals argued that duelists should be punished a lot more severely, regardless of their social standing. They argued that the punishment shouldn't be softer just because someone is closely affiliated with the Kaiser. The socialist politician August Bebel argued sarcastically, "If the gentlemen from the so-called higher classes bash each other's heads in, or gun each other down, we can basically object to very little. The more they engage in each other's self-destruction, the better for us." After a bit of debate, the Reichstag decided that it would do all in its power to punish all duelists equally. It all mattered very little, however, because the number of duels decreased to pretty much zero during the First World War. In 1938, there was a bit of a relapse when it was ordered that members of the SA, the SS, and the Wehrmacht should enter a duel in case of a severe defamation. 4 years later, however, the Führer himself strictly forbade any form of dueling, and this time Germany would not experience another relapse. But now, let's look at a question we haven't touched on yet. Who the hell actually wrote those damn letters? And the answer is, we don't know for sure. It certainly wasn't von Kotze, that much is clear. It could have been Ernst Günther von Schleswig-Holstein, who might have tried to distract everyone from his personal bad reputation, and instead blame everyone else. He certainly was at the top of the police's suspect list. Or could it possibly have been the host of the Grunewald party herself, Charlotte von Preußen? She had many sexual affairs outside of her marriage, and she openly despised the Duchess of Hohenau and many others. In the end, we just can't prove anything, and for the time being, it will remain a mystery.